Welcome to the lecture series on microprocessors. The subject code for the microprocessor is EC354, and today we are having the first lecture regarding the same. So let us start with introduction to microprocessors. So let us first go with the word what actually a microprocessor is. Microprocessor is normally a programmable control logic device which is being used to turn on and off devices. Basically, as the microprocessor is a digital device, it can understand only zeros and ones, the binary digits. Dependingly, if we want microprocessor to perform a certain task, then the binary instructions are supposed to be given to the microprocessor. That binary instructions which have been given to the microprocessor to perform a certain task is known as the machine language. Means microprocessor as a digital device can understand only zeros and ones, or you can say it can understand only machine language. Now, as human beings, we are unable to understand lots of zeros and ones if we put them all together, and it is cumbersome for us to read the zeros and ones written in line. So, for our convenience, we convert those binary instructions into human understandable form, and that is being known as mnemonics. So, whatever the program we write in the assembly language, we write the mnemonic which is understood to us. And by using an assembler software, that mnemonics are being converted into machine language, and that is being given to a microprocessor so it can work properly. So, let us start with the definition of a microprocessor. So we can define microprocessor, as the name suggests, micro and processor means a device which can process. Micro, you can say that a small device which can process. Moreover, dependingly we can define a microprocessor as an electronic device. It is an electronic device, it is a digital device. So, for the definition of a microprocessor, let us start making our vocabulary. Let us start with the word multipurpose. We have seen microprocessors used in so many electronic applications for the processing and the controlling part. So we can call microprocessor is a multi-purpose electronic device. There are so many applications of the microprocessor or where a microprocessor can fit. So a microprocessor is a multi-purpose electronic device, that we can say in the definition. What else we can say is that microprocessor is a programmable, and many times we say it is a reprogrammable device, means we can program it to perform a specific task. That's why we call microprocessor as a programmable device. We can write a program for a specific task. We can run the program into the memory, or we can store that program into the memory, and then the microprocessor reads the binary instruction from the memory and perform the specific task depending on the binary instructions which have been read from the microprocessor. So it is a multi-purpose electronic device. It is a programmable electronic device. The next thing that we can add to the definition is that it is a clock driven. It is clock driven. So microprocessor is a clock driven device. Means for the working of the microprocessor, an external clock signal is being given to the integrated circuit. So in synchronization with that clock signal, it will work. So microprocessor is a clock driven electronic device. Basically, the 8085 microprocessor works from 3 MHz to 5 or 6 MHz. So it is a clock driven electronic device. The next word that we can add, it is a register based electronic device, means for the temporary storage of data while executing the program, there are inbuilt registers which can store that data temporarily. So every microprocessor do have a set of registers for the temporary storage of the data. So there is a set of registers for the temporary storage of data in a microprocessor. So we can add all these four words in the definition. So we can sum up that microprocessor is a multi-purpose, programmable, clock-driven, register-based electronic device. That is the first thing that we can write for the definition of a microprocessor. Secondly, we can add that depending on the functionality of a microprocessor, that microprocessor reads the binary instructions from a storage area which is called memory, interprets that binary instructions from the input devices, processes it or carries out the processing and provides the output to the output device. So if we sum up all these things, then we can define a microprocessor is a multi-purpose, programmable, clock-driven, register-based electronic device which gets the binary instructions on the input side. It will process those binary instructions and provide the results on the output. So that will be the definition of a microprocessor. So after going through the definition of the microprocessor, let us first start discussing a programmable machine. Let us first start discussing a simple programmable machine. Let us start with a simple programmable machine. This simple programmable machine comprising of a microprocessor, input devices, output devices and a memory. That input is given to the microprocessor. So arrow will be in this side, that is the input devices. Then output that is coming out from the microprocessor, and for a memory we are then showing a bidirectional arrow. So this is a typical programmable machine. Now all these components, that is microprocessor, input, output, memory, all this will work together to make a microprocessor based system. So the same programmable machine can be used as a traffic light controller, or it can be used as an elevator controller. So for any microprocessor based system, this is a very simple programmable machine which can be used. So depending on a simple programmable machine, let us discuss the categories of microprocessor based system applications. Basically, there are two categories for the microprocessor application. The first one that is reprogrammable system. And the second one is embedded systems. Reprogrammable systems are the systems which can be reprogrammed, like a personal computer, for an example, which can be used for multiple applications. So different programs can be run on a personal computer, so that will came under a reprogrammable. On the other hand, embedded systems are the systems which are being made to perform specific tasks. Reprogrammable systems are for multi-purpose tasks. On the other hand, embedded systems are defined for specific tasks. Like we are having washing machines, microwave ovens, our tea coffee vending machines, they are typical examples of embedded. The ATM machine is also an example of an embedded. So basically, for an embedded system, the microprocessors which are being used are, that is, microcontrollers are being used, and general purpose processors are being used to make an embedded. So a microcontroller is having most of the part of the programmable machine on a same chip. On the other hand, a general purpose processor is the same as a microprocessor which is being used for embedded systems. So for embedded systems, the microprocessor which are being used, it can be a microcontroller or it can be a general purpose processor. Moreover, for the research oriented work, people nowadays are using FPGAs to implement their design for a particular embedded. So FPGAs also can be used for the development of an embedded. So this is all about the microprocessor application. Let us proceed further in our discussion and let us start with microprocessor as a CPU. Let us start with microprocessor as a CPU or a microprocessing unit. So, to understand the microprocessor as a CPU, let us first go through the generalized block diagram of a computer. So, a traditional block diagram of a computer comprising of input devices. These input devices are being given to the CPU, that is the central processing unit of the computer, and from that the results are being sent to the output devices after the processing. So what basically inside the CPU that we are supposed to see first. So most probably during 1960s, all the components of the CPU are being made up of discrete electronic devices. So let us see what we have inside the CPU. So inside the CPU, we are having a control unit. We are having ALU, that is arithmetic and logic unit, and we are having a memory. So the CPU comprising of some set of registers for the temporary storage of the data when the program is executing. If you have an arithmetic and logical unit to perform arithmetic and logical operations, the communication between all the blocks is being controlled by the control unit. So there are set of control signals in each and every microprocessor which is responsible for the proper communication between all the devices of a microprocessor. So that is the traditional block diagram of a computer. And as I told that in 1960, all these blocks are being made up of discrete electronic components. Now, as there is advancement in the technology, most of the part of the CPU is being put in a single chip or an integrated circuit is being made. So that will came with a block diagram of a microprocessor and a CPU. So that is being changed. That is being changed. And if I make the changes in this block diagram, then that is being changed. That is being changed, and this much part, this part, the ALU and the control unit, this ALU and control unit are being put inside an integrated circuit which is called microprocessor. So a computer with a microprocessor as a CPU or a microprocessing unit as a CPU is called a microcomputer. So that is a microcomputer, or a definition of a microcomputer. And this will be the block diagram of a microprocessor as a CPU of a microprocessing unit or MPU. So the inbuilt block in the microprocessor, as we have shown, only two blocks, that is arithmetic and logic block, as well as some control unit. It may have some encoder decoder circuitry, incremental for the memory. So there are few other circuitries also which are inside this integrated circuit, that is the microprocessor. Now there is again advancement in the semiconductor technology, as there is advancement in the VLSI technology. So the most of the components of a microprocessor and CPU, as we are seeing in the block diagram, most of the components are being put on the same chip, but with few limitations. So let us see what we have if we put most of the components on a single chip. Like if I make a single chip and putting all the blocks that we have seen, say MPU is on chip, we are having memory on chip, IO input output device is on chip, and we are having peripheral devices on chip, like A to D converter, like a serial port, and a timer or counter. So if all these blocks are on the same chip, then this will become a microcontroller. So this is a typical block diagram of a microcontroller with most of the blocks on a same chip. Now this is having limitations in terms of memory. The memory is fixed, that is being fixed by the manufacturer. So there is a criteria to choose a microcontroller. So this will be the block diagram of a microcontroller, which is having an on-chip microprocessing unit, memory, IO, peripheral devices, and the examples of the peripheral devices are an A to B converter, a serial block, a timer or a counter. So that is all about microprocessor as a CPU. Let us proceed further in our discussion, and let us start with a question that how does the microprocessor work? Let us start with the question. We have gone through the definition. Now let us discuss in detail how exactly the microprocessor works. What the working, what the functionality of a microprocessor? Now see that to understand the functionality or the working of a microprocessor, we need to assume that the binary instructions or the program for which the microprocessor is supposed to work is already stored in the memory. Means the program is already set in the memory of the microprocessor. Now, once the program is ready and is there in form of binary instructions in the memory,
Let us take an example that we have written a program which will add two numbers and display the result on the 7th segment screen of a microprocessor kit. Let us take an example that a program will add two numbers and it will display the result on 7th segment screen of the microprocessor kit. So that binary instructions we are assuming that are already stored into the memory. And now we are going for how does the microprocessor work. That's how exactly the microprocessor is working. For that we are going for. To understand the proper concept, let us take one example. If a radio kit is being given to a sample, the process behind for the assembling of that radio kit is the same as the working of the microprocessor. So initially, if a radio kit is being given for assembly, what a student or person or a hobbyist will do is that he or she will read the instruction in the instruction manual. So to assemble a radio kit, the first operation that is being done is to read the instruction manual. Once the step by step instructions are being read, then a particular step is being interpreted. So the next interpret what is being read from the instruction manual. After reading and interpreting, the assembling is being performed. So the third word is performed. So to assemble a radio kit, the read, interpret and perform cycle is being done continuously till the whole radio kit is being assembled. So there are three words: read, interpret, perform. Read, interpret, perform. So this is being done continuously till all the steps are being finished and the radio kit is assembled. The same is the case of a microprocessor. We are assuming the binary instructions are stored in the memory. So the microprocessor reads the binary instructions from the memory, decodes it, means it will interpret those binary instructions and it will perform depending on the binary instructions which is being read from the memory. So microprocessor also performs the read operation from the memory. It will take the binary instructions, interpret by using the internal circuitry and perform the task which is being specified by that particular binary instruction. So the read is being represented by the fetch operation in the microprocessor, means microprocessor fetches the binary instructions from the memory. Interpret is being done by the decoder circuitry, so we call it a decode as an interpret, and perform is represented by execute. Execution of the binary instruction by the microprocessor. So we are having these three words, that is fetch, decode, execute. So if you want to answer the question, the answer is in these three words, that is fetch, decode and execute. So a microprocessor fetches the binary instructions from the memory using the decoder circuitry, decode that instruction and execute that instruction. So again, it will fetch the instructions, decode the instructions, execute the instructions. So this fetch, decode, execute cycle will run continuously till the last instruction is being reached. And for a microprocessor based application, the last instruction will be a halt instruction in an assembly language program, means to stop execution. Or in C language it is end, means means again you stop the execution. So that is how does the microprocessor work, and using this three words we can explain the working of the microprocessor. So let us proceed further with few definitions that we are supposed to learn. So let us proceed further with the definition, like hardware, software, and firmware. Let us go with the basic definition. So let us start with the hardware. All the physical components of a computer, which can be electronic, mechanical, optical, magnetic, they will called as, or they are called as hardware. All the physical components of a computer. Now see that the sequence of instructions which are stored in a memory, the microprocessor reads that instruction one by one and performs the task. So that sequence of instructions are being called program. So sequence of instructions is known as program. And a set of programs will make a software. Now there are basically system softwares and user system softwares, like an operating system, or it can be an assembler, compiler, interpreter, or a debugger. An operating system is nothing but a supervisory program which will supervise the other application, or on which the other applications will run. So it will provide a platform for the application programs to run. The definition of an assembler is that it will convert an assembly language program into machine understandable form or into machine language. Compiler does the same thing, it will convert high level language program into machine language program. A debugger is a software which will logically detect the flaws in the program, and by using the debugger we can improve the quality of the program logically. As far as the user programs are concerned, they are application programs which will run on the operating system. On the other hand, for small embedded systems, when operating system is not required, the particular task which is being performed by that particular embedded system is stored permanently into the flash memory of the microcontroller, and that is being known as firmware. For an example, a tea coffee vending machine, then if an operating system is not being required for that, so a dedicated program is being written and burned into the flash memory of that microcontroller. So that program is called as firmware for that small application. Now, along with assemblers and compilers, there are cross assemblers and cross compilers. The word cross is being added as a suffix to the assembler and a compiler. The reason behind that is that if we take an example of a cross assembler like KB Vision 4 that we are going to use for 8051 programming later in this semester. Now, what that cross assembler is doing is that whatever the program you are writing, that program you are writing for the external microcontroller, not for the computer. So your computer is the host machine, and you are using KVM4 for an example or an integrated development environment of any kind for the development purpose. Means you are writing the program, assembling it or compiling it, making a machine understandable program, and that program is being put on some other system which is external to the computer. Means the target system and the host system are different. That's why it is being known as cross-assembler or cross-compiler, in which the host and the target systems are different. That's why C compiler is. But when the host and the target systems are different, we are supposed to go with cross-assemblers or cross-compilers. So normally for microcontrollers, we are supposed to use cross-assembler or cross-compilers. So after going through the basic definition, let us start with the concept of memory. Let us start with the basic concept of memory. Later on we are having in detail. So basically for a microprocessor based system, we do have memory for the temporary storage of data as well as for the permanent storage of programs which we had designed and we had put it inside the memory for a particular task to run. So for an example, if we take an example of a computer, then the CPU of a computer is running at very high speed. And in a computer, we do have a primary memory and a secondary memory. Primary memory for the temporary storage of data, secondary memory like magnetic disk and optical disk for the permanent storage of data. Means the primary memory is volatile, secondary is non-volatile. Now see that many times the working speed of a CPU is very high. Means the microprocessor or a CPU is executing the instructions much more faster than the retrying rate of the memory, because the semiconductor memories are slower in nature. So to compensate that, there is a concept of cache memory, which will work as a bridge between the microprocessor and memory, and whatever the instructions which are being required by the microprocessor, they are being temporarily stored in the cache memory and they are always ready to be taken by the microprocessor. So this is eventually speed up the microprocessor. So for a computer, we do have a cache memory. This is the concept of a cache memory, a primary memory and a secondary memory. Okay. Now, as far as the microprocessor based system is concerned, we are having semiconductor memory. We are having semiconductor memory. There are two types of semiconductor memory. The first one is RAM and the second one is ROM. The full form of RAM is random access memory. It is a volatile memory, means it is being used for the temporary storage of data during the program execution. So that is the RAM, that is random access memory. We should have ROM, that is read only memory, that is a non-volatile memory and used for the permanent storage of the programs. There are two types of RAM we are having. We are having static RAM and dynamic RAM. There are two types of RAM. a dendrogram and dendrogram. Now see that, as the name is there, static and dynamic. Both are volatile in nature. Static RAM retains its content till the next power off is there. On the other hand, dynamic RAM did not retain the content. It needs a refreshing circuit. Because dynamic RAM is made up of capacitors. So there is a charge discharge cycle. So it requires a refreshing circuitry or a control circuitry to charge the capacitors so it can retain the value even if the power is being given continuously. Now see that static RAM is much more faster than the dynamic RAM. But due to the packing density of dynamic RAM is much more than static RAM because only one transistor is being used to make a memory cell of a DRAM, and for SRAM there are 6 transistors are being used to make a memory cell. So as far as the packing density is concerned, we do have large sizes of DRAM available in market. On the other hand, SRAM came with smaller size as far as the number of bytes are concerned. Now we do have many types of DRAM, like we are having integrated RAM, which is again a type of dynamic RAM in which the refreshing and the controlling circuitry is being included on the same chip. So we are having integrated DRAM. We are having SDRAM, that is synchronous DRAM. We are having SGRAM, that is synchronous graphics RAM, which is being used for the graphics application. We are having DDR RAM, which is again a dynamic RAM, and the word is double data rate. DDR is double data rate, means it will work double, the speed of working is double to SDRAM. Because of the working size, it will work on the starting edge of the clock as well as the ending edge of the clock. The data can be sent or received during both the edges of the clock. In SDRAM, it is on the starting edge only. So the data rate is doubled in the DDR, and the fastest RAM that we have is the RAM bus RAM available in market. So for the temporary storage of data, we do have RAM. There are two types of RAM, that is a static RAM and a DRAM. As far as the ROM is concerned, that is non-volatile in nature, earlier we are having PROMs, that is programmable read-only memory. After PROM we get EPROM, which is electrically programmable read-only memory, like UEPROM is an example of an EPROM. Then we are having E2PROM, that is electrically programmable and erasable read-only memory. And nowadays we are having flash ROM, and we are having NVRAM, which are being used as a ROM in a microcontroller based system. The name of the flash ROM, the flash is being given because it can be programmed and erased in a moment of time. That's why the name flash is being given. It is a flash memory. And a non-volatile RAM in some cases are being used as ROM in a microcontroller based system. So this is the introduction regarding the semiconductor memory. We do have a RAM, ROM. We have gone through the different types of RAM in terms of static RAM and dynamic RAM. And as far as ROM is concerned, we are having ROM, EEPROM, E2ROM, flash and NVRAM. After the semiconductor memory, there is one more concept. There is one more concept that we will go through very quickly. As far as the memory is concerned, we are having a concept of program memory and data memory. As the name suggests, program memory is the memory where the program is to be stored or the binary instruction is to be stored. So the program memory is nothing but the ROM where the permanent programs or data are to be stored permanently, or the programs are to be stored permanently to perform a specific task for that particular embedded system or a microcontroller based system. So that will came under program memory. On the other hand, data memory will store the temporary data which is being used during the program execution. All the registers reside in data memory. So the data memory is nothing but the RAM that we use. So basically, when we are discussing microcontrollers, in microcontrollers normally we do have on-chip memory. So it can be categorized as a program memory and a data memory. Program memory resembles ROM and data memory resembles that. That is all we have in today's lecture. Thank you very much.